Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Hans-Wilhelm Schiffer, as Executive Chair of WEC's World Energy Resources Program. It's up to me to moderate this session on the topic Decarbonising the Future, the Role of CCS. At the beginning of our session, a few remarks from my side, organizatory remarks. First, we are happy to present you with a new innovative way to ask questions and evaluate during the, today's session. Kindly access the mobile website or the Congress app WEC 2016, and under each session title you will find Ask and Rate button. Kindly submit your questions via the Ask button. We will try to answer your questions as much as the time permits, and at the end of the session you are kindly requested to evaluate the session by clicking on the Rate button. Coming to the content of the session, also at the beginning of the session, a very few remarks from my side. Today, the share of fossil fuels in total primary energy consumption is more than 80%. And we have heard about the new scenarios of the World Energy Council, and the one of the results is that even in 2060, 50 to 70% of the total primary energy consumption has to be covered by fossil fuels. That means the goals of the Paris Agreement on climate change are unachievable absent a global commitment to CCS that currently does not exist. CCS is the only is not only necessary to reduce the emissions in coal or gas-fired power stations, but we also need CCS in order to diminish the CO2 emissions in industrial processes. Due to the fifth assessment report of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, achieving the 2-degree goal without CCS would mean 138% increase in total discounted mitigation costs between 2015 and 2100. Without CCS, the costs would be twice as high in comparison to using this technology. I have the honor to introduce four highly respected discussion leaders for this session. And these are Hilde Gunnur Thorsteinsson, Senior Vice President, Reykjavik Energy. Previously, she led the Hydrothermal and Resource Confirmation Team at the U.S. Department of Energy. John Scott is Chief Risk Officer for Zurich Global Corporate. He leads the global, regional, and local implementation of the group's enterprise risk management strategy across Zurich's global corporate business. Amit Kumar, third person in this role, has been working on the development and creation of innovative solutions for a sustainable future concentrated on cleaner and renewable sources for over 30 years at the Energy and Resources Institute in New Delhi, the well-known Terry Institute. And Christian Bach is Executive Secretary of UNECE. UNECE's major aim is to promote pan-European economic integration. Christian previously was member of the Danish Parliament and served as Denmark's Minister for Development Cooperation. After introducing our four discussion leaders, I would like them to present their viewpoint on the following questions. What are the main drivers and barriers relevant to boosting CCS capacity in the upcoming decades? What are the key innovation stories? And what policies and instruments are needed to deliver CCS at the scale? Christian, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, and thank you to the organizers for the invitation to be here. I think the the week is a great event and a good event also to exchange experiences, viewpoints on critical issues as CCS. In UNECE, we have for years hosted what is called a group of experts on cleaner electricity production from fossil fuels. So we are part of the UN where we have dealt with fossil fuels and have done so for long. And this group of experts, they have developed the recommendations on CCS, carbon capture and storage, for the UNFCCC negotiations in order to position this technology as part of the solutions that we need in order to create a 2-degree pathway. And with the numbers you just read out, how much it will increase the mitigation cost without this technology are very forceful coming out of the fifth assessment report. And we also know that for a 2-degree pathway, we need to leave approximately 80% of the coal in the ground of existing known resources, 50% of the oil has to be left, and 30% of the gas has to be left. Now, will this happen? It will not. We heard the minister from Saudi Arabia and the minister of energy and industry and minerals this morning saying there will be no stranded resources. If we are to have these two realities meet each other, we need carbon capture and storage. But it is moving way too slow. The technology, we've been discussing it 15 years, but we haven't seen the real breakthrough. We have also larger scale projects now up running, where we have projects in Norway that have been quite successful running for years, but we really lack the scale up of the technology. What we focus on in the UN and in the work we do is a number of issues. First and foremost, it's policy parity. Simply treating carbon that you capture with CCS technology and store or reuse or whatever, treat that carbon equal with other kinds of carbon. If governments just did this, we could create a stronger incentive for the technology. So policy parity, carbon should be carbon. But of course, we need to make sure that we can measure and monitor whether CCS carbon is actually taken away from the atmosphere and is safely stored. And we have to have the technology and the means to monitor and measure it. We need to develop new and better investment frameworks, innovative investment frameworks in support of the technology. We lack it, and there's a need for leveraging here, because obviously companies are shying away from taking the risk alone. Governments are not seeing the right incentives internationally either, so we need new innovative financial mechanisms to support the technology, and this should hopefully lead us to have even larger scale plants with CCS technology where we can really boost and move the technology. But what our experts have told us, and these recommendations from our group has been endorsed and supported by 56 member states, the US and Canada, all the way to Russia and Tajikistan, those are our member states, they have supported these recommendations, and they say if we get policy parity, large-scale plants now up running, new financial mechanisms, and we also allow the carbon captured to be reused for extraction of other types of fossil fuels. If we do this, then we can have a technology that is technologically feasible, economically viable, and that can really help us to reach a 2-degree pathway. We heard also the minister from Saudi Arabia this morning saying carbon capture and usage, as he said it, would be up, in his opinion, running within years and large-scale facilities, not in decades, he said, but within years, so the technology can be there, and we desperately need it if you want a 2-degree pathway. We desperately need it, and we may even need to combine it with biofuel in order to capture carbon and make sure that we not only avoid further release of greenhouse gases, but that we actually withdraw the greenhouse gases, CO2, from the atmosphere. And it can be done with bioenergy and carbon capture and storage. It may be very soon, unfortunately, one of the very necessary technologies that we have to venture into in order to avoid a climate catastrophe and reach a 2-degree pathway. So this is our role, and in the UN, trying to bring it together and trying to build the best recommendations, best practices that can support governments and companies to get this done. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Christian. And now we come to our next session leader, Koma. If you could point out your main points you would like to address before we come to further questions.
Thank you, Chairman. And I would also like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to share our views. In order to look into carbon capture and its sequestration from India's perspective, I would first of all like to set the context. And the context is that we have about little over 300 gigawatt of installed capacity for electricity generation, out of which 63% is coming from coal. Renewables are constituting about 14%, without counting large hydro into that. But despite of this much of capacity, we are still dealing with huge shortages. In fact, there is about 40 gigawatt of captive power plants used mainly by industries and commercial organizations, most of them using diesel as the fuel. So if I look at the challenges we are facing, over 237 million people are still without access to electricity, and even in places and especially the rural areas which are electrified, the electricity supply is quite erratic. We are also facing challenge of rapid urbanization, rapid economic growth, which all of us want, and industrial expansion. So if I were to summarize, we have concerns of energy access, sustained energy growth, and energy security. And all of these to be dealt with in the overall framework of global climate change modalities. Industry is the largest consumer of energy, about 40%. As far as emissions are concerned, energy sector constitute most, 66%. And within energy sector, electricity generation constitutes 72%. So this is the context in which we looked at CCS in India. We did a scoping study about 3 years ago with support from Global CCS Institute Australia, and we looked into different aspects of that and had a number of consultations with different stakeholders. The main point which comes out is that by way of going through CCS route, the cost of generation increases about 41 to 42%, whether we are using indigenous coal or we are using imported coal. And the second point is that it also results into penalty in terms of reduced power output, because auxiliary power consumption increases quite a bit. So the main barriers when we looked at introducing CCS, because all said and done, CCS is very relevant for a country which is relying so much on coal-based power generation. But again, when we looked into the barriers, the point was that apart from those two barriers, we are on one side, you are having penalty in terms of reduced power generation, when on one side, you are trying to meet increasing energy demands and going in for universal energy access, that becomes quite troublesome. And on top of that, the cost of power generation increases quite a bit. The point also is that one major barrier of CCS in India is that we don't have very accurate information and data sources as far as geological sites are concerned. If you are talking of sequestering so much quantity of CO2, where we are going to pump that in and whether those sites are safe or not. We also considered that whether this captured CO2 could be used for enhanced oil recovery. But the largest producer of oil in India, namely the ONGC Limited, very clearly told us that we don't have that many depleted oil fields as yet where you can pump in this CO2 and going for enhanced oil recovery. A very major factor which came out of the discussion was that how we are going to monitor the CO2 which we are going to pump in underground. And what the veracity of the fact that CO2 is not being leaked. So the whole aspect of monitoring, verification, and the infrastructure around that, that again is something considered to be a big barrier for adoption of CCS in India. And especially from the point of view of whether and if it contaminate the underground water. And on around all of these, there is a question of the capacity building, the capacities and the collaboration, all those things are constituted big barriers. And that's why in our overall low carbon economic pathways, I have not seen that CCS comes anywhere, forget about prominently, CCS comes at all in the picture at all. So these were the few things which I thought I would share with you. And also considering the public perception around safety of nuclear power generation in India, the public perception also has to be tackled as far as introduction of CCS is concerned, again from the point of view of safety aspect, how that stored CO2 is going to behave when we are talking of in perpetuity. Thank you very much.
Great, thanks very much. And thank you to the other speakers for bringing out these interesting points about CCS. So it's called Decarbonising the Future. We all know what happened in COP21 last year and the commitments we all have made, or those 55 countries we hope was 55% of the emissions who agree to make those commitments. If we do all of that, it's very, very challenging to do it with the current set of infrastructure and approach, whether it's in energy, whether it's in transportation, or whether it's in heat and gas for cooking, for example. And so there's CCS just is such an important component of achieving the reductions that we expect to make in COP21. And without it, quite frankly, these reductions are not going to happen. So why hasn't this technology or this group of technologies been implemented much more quickly when everybody understands that? And I think it's useful looking at some of the lessons from the CCS projects that have happened so far around the world. I think one of the big challenges is that, you know, at COP21, everyone, it slips off the tongue, doesn't it? 21. What's that 21 mean? 21 means 21 years since Kyoto. So that's a very, very long time for people to get to an agreement about doing something to save the planet. And we can't wait that long. So that, why has it taken that long? Because of a lot of very complicated and difficult political issues. Not technology. Every one of the component technologies of CCS is very well understood, either from the oil and gas industry, or from the industrial gases industry, or from the chemicals industry. It's very easy to capture and strip out carbon dioxide from a stream of other gases. It's easy to transport it. We've been doing it for many years. There's many carbon dioxide pipelines in many parts of the world. And it's very easy to reinject into either an old oil and gas field or a saline aquifer. These have been demonstrated for many years. The Sleipner field in the North Sea, Gorgon in Australia. There's really good examples where carbon dioxide has been stored safely and will obviously stay for a very long time underground. So what are the barriers? The barriers are typically the real challenges that lots of new or novel technologies have suffered from. There's certainly a sense of not in my backyard. So onshore, deep subsurface carbon capture and storage has been the subject of public disquiet, people not really being sure. You mean you've got to put waste underneath my town? That doesn't feel very safe to me. And then I think there's been a very strong You know, and everybody who's been around for the last 21 years since Kyoto knows this, that there's been a very strong anti-carbon industry lobby, even to the extent where, you know, it's almost like a war. I seem to remember there was a really good book called The Carbon War by Jeremy Leggett, written shortly after Kyoto, which described the political shenanigans between the pro-carbon and anti-carbon lobby. When you look at pieces of legislation or policy like the Carbon Capture and Storage Directive in Europe, it is very, very clear the way it's been written is that it is impossible, if you want to follow the CCS directive, to actually do CCS in Europe. It just has so many conditions, not least of all the requirement for financial security up front in cash payment for any future possible liability related to carbon dioxide leaking from a store. I'm sorry, no individual private company would ever take that condition. And that's written into the directive. And you know why? It's because very well-meaning people who want to, or who see the solution to climate change being stopping the carbon-intensive industries, had that written in. So that's why CCS has such a bad publicity, because people have painted it, environmentalists have painted it as somehow perpetuating the carbon industries, where in fact, it turns out, it is absolutely not the only technology, but a key technology, along with many others, to decarbonizing the future. And I think that's my other point I really want to make here, is CCS is not actually a technology. CCS is a combination of activities that drives decarbonization across multiple areas of an economy. It's not just about taking the carbon dioxide from a major power generating source and putting it underground, storing it forever. It's about decarbonizing many of the industrial processes which we rely on for GDP growth. Think of what drives infrastructure. Cement, iron and steel, glass, and let's think about agriculture. So fertiliser, all of these processes, any of you who's a chemist in the room would understand these are big carbon dioxide emitting processes of which there's no alternative right now. And so we have to find a way of decarbonising those industries as well, and linked to that, decarbonising the transportation industry. And I mentioned also gas for heating. In many countries, gas is used as a source for heating domestically and for cooking. And so CCS has a role in there too, in enabling low-carbon hydrogen generation and the generation of the hydrogen economy. Hydrogen low-carbon for use either in fuel cells, in particular for heavy transport, but also hydrogen for use in the home for cooking and heating. And it's CCS that enables that to happen. And so the final point I want to make is that we cannot rely on economics alone to drive CCS. For a long time, people felt that the appropriate mix of technologies, low-carbon technologies, would be driven in some way by a carbon price. It's quite obvious that the decisions of COP21 with the nationally determined reduction commitments, there's no such thing as a global carbon tax or a global cap and trade system. These things just don't work. It's tough enough to make them work on a regional level. And so in the absence of an economic driver, what is really important is to have a really clear, levelized cost approach to understanding the value or the cost of technologies like CCS versus the others, and recognizing the initial cost of infrastructure, the cost of building pipelines, which is significant. But once you've built that infrastructure, and this is a role for government to participate with private enterprise, the marginal cost per ton of additional carbon dioxide that you store is minimal. So ultimately, I think, policymakers need to understand this. They need to encourage the development of CCS, as much for economic regeneration in areas which rely on old industries, iron and steel, coal, cement, and regenerate those economies by putting in place CCS as part of a wide range of technologies that will help drive our low carbon future.
I completely agree with what has been said by you. You can take Germany as an example. Politicians in the first step were in favor of CCS. then environmental groups opposed against CCS, and it came to the point that also the local people were not in favor of CCS anymore. The local people in the area where CO2 should be stored, and the result was that we got a law which makes it nearly impossible to store CCS within Germany, at least onshore. And another point you also mentioned, the CCS price is not sufficient to make CCS possible. Take the example of renewables. It was not the CCS price which accelerated the deployment of renewables. We need a funding system also for CCS. Then we can expect a similar development and also possibly a similar learning curve which has been achieved in the case of renewables. But now I would like to come to you, Hilde Kunwer, and I would like to ask you to tell us your viewpoint.
I'd like to address the innovation part of CCS. I come from a company that, and it addresses some of the points that have been covered, the cost, the not in our backyard, and the trust of the public. And so a project that we've been doing now for several years in Iceland is a very good example of what a small-scale demonstration can do for public acceptance and the success of the technology. And so the beauty in the technology we're using is its simplicity, and it's a different approach, and it's different in twofold. Firstly, what we do is we don't rely on an impermeable cap rock to keep the buoyant CO2 in the subsurface. And we do this by completely dissolving the CO2 in water before and pushing it into the subsurface that way. And you can imagine sparkling water and you have the CO2 bubbles, but if you dissolve the CO2 even more, the bubbles disappear, and that's the fluid that we're injecting into the ground. And secondly, we are injecting into basaltic host rock. And so basalts in Iceland, when the CO2 charged water reacts with the basaltic rocks, it turns into carbonates, it turns into rock, it's a mineral. And so because the CO2 has turned into rock or minerals, it is a very safe storage method requiring minimal monitoring. And before we did this project, it was thought that mineralization of this sort would take on the order of hundreds to 1,000 years. And what we've shown with our field test is that 95% of the CO2 is mineralized within 2 years. And so how much does it cost? Recent cost estimates of CO2 or CCS have shown that costs range from $60 to $130 per ton. Much of that cost comes from the capture of CO2, almost 90%. And so you're capturing pure CO2 or almost pure CO2, and that's why it's expensive. Because we rely on a much simpler way of capturing soluble gases in water and then directly injecting that water into the ground, our costs are much lower, or about $30 per ton. We started this project as a pure R&D project. Scientists came to us, we had everything we needed to test the idea, we had CO2, we had water, and we had wells drilled into basaltic rocks. The reason we had this is because we're a geothermal company. We produce geothermal power. And so, in reality, CO2 is not a large issue or big issue in our daily operations. And so the driver, I think, of what has led us to now scale up the operation to industrial scale has been more actually regulation than R&D. And it's not regulation on CO2, it's regulation on hydrogen sulfide. And so along with the gas, with the steam we take from the ground to produce electricity, we get CO2, but we also get H2S, or hydrogen sulfide. And hydrogen sulfide is regulated in Iceland. And so to meet our regulatory requirements, we had to reduce our emissions. And we looked at traditional ways to get rid of the hydrogen sulfide, but these are capital intensive and high operational costs for us. So we decided to develop our gas to rock method further. And we now inject both CO2 and H2S into the ground. it's about 20, we inject about 25% of the CO2, which is about 10,000 tons a year, and 75% of the H2S. So by relying on innovation and thinking outside the box, we have managed to save our company millions of dollars. And in a company that almost went bankrupt in the Icelandic financial crisis, as we were dealing with regulation and other challenges, this has been extremely important. So to close, I'd just like to remind everyone how important innovation is in the big picture. And even though many of the technologies are established, it's important to carve out a niche for innovation. And our technology won't be the silver bullet that solves climate change, but it's a new weapon in our armory against global warming.
Thank you very much, Hilde Gunnor. That's a very interesting project and research result that CO2 can be mineralized within 2 years. The question is, and before I would like to ask the audience to address further questions, I would like to address one question to each of you. And the first question would be to Hilde Gunnor. Can this interesting technology only be applied in Iceland, or could it be also used elsewhere in the world? Because that is, of course, of real importance.
So what you need is CO2, and I think we have plenty of that in the world. You need water. And you need basalt, so basaltic rocks. And so about 10% of the world continents have basaltic rocks. India has it, the northwestern United States, the Middle East, and also almost all of the ocean floor. And so this technology can definitely be applied elsewhere.
Okay, thank you. One question to you, John. How does CCS work with the expected advances from the fourth industrial revolution to achieve COP21 goals?
Right. So the fourth industrial revolution. I think one of the speakers in the previous main session referred to technology as a huge driver, or digitalization as a huge driver of change in the next 40 years for the energy industry. And it is absolutely clear that the fourth industrial revolution, which is really the confluence of the physical, the digital, and the biotechnological domains, will dramatically change our world in an exponential way, and in a way that the previous three industrial revolutions completely changed our world, not only economically, but societally as well. I think from the perspective of decarbonising the future, what's extremely clear is that the future is not going to be driven by how we operate today if we're going to achieve the goals of COP21. I think each country has to find a solution to their own version of the energy trilemma: energy security, low-cost energy, and low-carbon energy. And what that means is that technologies, in the sense of the use of smart grid, the Internet of Things, being able to turn down demand for air conditioners, for fridges, for things that are not needed at a particular time across the whole grid area, and also building in local generation, whether that's renewable, wind, solar, or whether it's by any other means, essentially will allow the grid to be balanced in a way that we need fewer big point sources, grid-scale sources of power generation. And this is something that's going on in China right now in terms of their energy policy. I think this is happening on a regional level there. And it's something that, of course, we should look at in all countries. And what that means, of course, if we need fewer big power stations, we also need to use technology to balance the types of power that we generate and its own characteristics. So, for example, the intermittency that comes with renewables. So the wind doesn't always blow, the sun doesn't always shine. So going back to Germany, actually paradoxically, Germany, since it instituted its big push to have mainly wind and solar power, means actually they're burning more coal now than ever, because coal is cheap, imported from the USA because of the shale gas phenomenon. And so Germany, despite their desire to be green, actually is producing a lot of carbon dioxide right now because they have to cover up those periods where power is not being generated by the renewable power. And of course, fossil fuel at the moment is also the only real energy source that we can turn up or down at will very quickly. So when there's energy peak demand, for example, after the favorite soap opera has finished on TV and everybody rushes out to, well, in the UK, make a cup of tea, somewhere else maybe a little snack, turns on the oven or whatever, they turn on the kettle. The only way to achieve that spike is with a large fossil fuel plant at the moment. Unless you've got some version of grid-scale storage, which, of course, some countries have where you have a lot of hydro, where you can have a lot of pump storage, for example, fossil fuel still is the only way of doing it. So that's not going to change over time, but we need to use technology from the fourth industrial revolution to manage not only demand, but also to manage the decarbonizing of the supply. And, of course, CCS is just another really important component of that suite of technologies that we have to apply across the energy, transportation, and industrial sources of carbon dioxide.
Thank you very much, John. Now come to Amit. My question to Amit is, what is the government of India's position on adapting CCS in India? Because India is a very important country with increasing coal consumption. The position of the Indian government would be quite important to know.
See, we will have to look at carbon capture in two ways. One is carbon capture and utilization of that captured CO2 in some industries for a variety of purposes, as very clearly told by him also. And another is carbon capture, storage and sequestration. Now, as far as Government of India's policies are concerned, if an industry has to use captured carbon in any of its processes, it can always go in for that. And there are industries, particularly in cement sector and in chloralkali sector, are trying out those options. But as I explained, the major problem in climate change debate, which is actually driving CCS, is coming from how coal is being used in power generation. So then there could be two options. Either we capture that CO2 from those power plants and use it for industries. Again, for that, the suitable industry has to be close to where the power is being produced, A. But more importantly, that industry or a set of industries should be able to utilize that much quantum of CO2 which is being produced by large power plants. And second is that you simply capture CO2 from power plants and sequester it. So the Government of India's position, that's why, has been more focusing on CCS in conjunction with power generation. And there the problem, apart from the two which I mentioned, which are in terms of penalty as far as power generation is concerned and penalty in terms of higher cost, it's that nowhere in the world it has been demonstrated at sufficiently large scale. Now please remember that in India, the power plants which are coming up based on coal are all in the range of 4 to 5 gigawatt. So where are the demonstrated examples that, yes, you are able to apply CCS at that scale, in that range? Also, we don't have that luxury of having seaside or seawater everywhere where our power plants are concerned. Our coal power plants are scattered all over India, and most of them in landlocked area. So that means we don't have option of injecting that CO2 in water all the time. So that means the safe storage space for those captured CO2 becomes very important. So that's why Government of India is very clear that yes, they do consider this as a potentially useful technology or a set of technology, as explained by my colleague. The point is that instead of looking at CCS as an interim arrangement, which we all used to think that before renewables become cost effective, we would be able to utilize CCS. That option doesn't seem to be very attractive at the moment. So Government of India's position is that they will rather wait and watch rather than starting something and putting up risk onto the Indian soil. It has also been noted that even when we considered wind or solar, we actually went into large scale only once large scale deployment of these technologies were apparent and were successful elsewhere. Wind, for example, in Denmark, and solar in US, and most notably in the Germany. Then only we took up all those things. So same applies here, even with more caution. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Amit, for the interesting insights. Last question to Christian, very easy one, but it's important, your answer, because your organization is very important and you are influential. And my question is, what role can the UN play in bringing the technology forward?
Well, hopefully we can help shape some consensus. That's what the UN is all about. It's consensus, not only between countries, but also between stakeholders. And what we hear is, of course, that there has been initiatives, there has been demonstration plans, there has been policies in place, but then civil society has often come out skeptical, even heavily against the CCS technology. And I'm not saying that we can overcome all the resistance, but I hope we can shape some consensus in the UN. And the recommendations we did for UNFCCC on carbon capture and storage was a unique step. 56 countries are behind these recommendations. They are endorsed by member states. And here you suddenly have member states coming together with experts and delegates and civil society trying to shape a pathway for CCS technology. I think that's hugely important. And there's also a political aspect of CCS that I think we haven't touched upon, because I see it, the technological need for CCS, but I also see the political need for it. Because right now, fossil fuel producers and large fossil fuel consumers have been only part of the problem. And there has been no pathway for them also to maneuver politically in the climate negotiations. If we really manage to bring in CCS as a viable alternative and technology, then we can turn all those who have been seen up to now as only being part of the problem, we can bring them in as also being part of the solution. And we heard the minister from Saudi Arabia this morning talking about new investments in gas and in fossil fuels, but also hopeful that carbon capture and usage could be the solution that can allow him to do it within a viable 2-degree pathway. We need to keep all those ministers accountable, of course. They have to live up to the promises they have given in Paris in December. And Paris is not nowhere enough. Sometimes I fear that Paris may even become an excuse for not doing anything more. Because now we say, okay, we did it in Paris, so job done. Paris is not no near to be enough. So we need to keep everybody accountable now. And those who say, yes, fossil fuels, and we'll do CCS, they have to invest in it. Big time, big time. It has to come. And it's not enough that India says, we will wait and see, and if something comes tomorrow, it's today, and it's right now, we have to develop this technology. And here the UN, we can hopefully help, as said, bridge policy choices, policy parity, also engage in new innovative financial instruments that can help the industry, and then recommendations also on the geological resources and the spots where we can use CCS. We host in UNEC, apart from the CCS work, we also host the UN framework classification for fossil fuels and mineral reserves. And here, this framework classification is used to identify the very best energy resources that we should invest in, not only from technical, but also from economic, social, environmental impact. And this UN framework classification, we can actually use the same methodology to identify the best spots on planet where we can use the CCS technology. So if we could develop this, then we can get safe mineralization, hopefully building on the expertise from Iceland. We can find the best spots by using a framework classification that can allow us thereby to move the technology also in a technical manner. So this is what we can offer in the UN, but the only way we can do it is that if you all come to the UN, if you come to the expert group, and we invite civil society, we invite governments, come and help develop the best recommendations and practices in the world for the CCS technology, and then it can move forward.
Thank you very much, Christian, for the clear statement. That helps a lot, and I think the UN is such an important organization. If you promote it, we can be successful in the future. I would now like to invite the audience to pose brief questions to the speakers. Please introduce yourself when you ask our discussion leaders. Let us know to whom you address your question, and keep the intervention brief, and please avoid a statement, just a question. And there's not much time, so we can have to limit it to three or four questions, and then we expect the answers from our discussion leaders.
Yes, I'm François Dassard from EDF in France. I have a question about the pace at which, with this technology which has been described and which is appears to be very promising, the pace at which you could inject CO2. In France, we have made investigations about the quality of the aquifers, for instance, and unfortunately, it appeared that the quality was not good enough. So you had potentially large reservoirs, but you could not inject at the pace which was required, for instance, for 2 degrees Celsius, unless you provoked earthquakes. So is there some kind of limitation in those basaltic soils you are mentioning? At what pace could you inject CO2?
So, as you might know, Iceland is a very seismically active country, and which is one of the reasons why we have geothermal. And so where we inject the CO2 is actually in a seismically active zone. And so we are used to seismic events, and we do get tremors from our injection. We have to manage, I think the main thing that you have to know the stress of the field where you're injecting into, you have to know what kind of flow rates you can allow yourself. So it depends on the field. And we have systems in place to manage that, along with a lot of public outreach to educate what we're doing, how we're doing it, and how we're managing the risk. And so now I think we've gotten public acceptance on that point, which wasn't really related to the CO2, but more we re-inject all the water from our geothermal plant. We re-inject about 800 to 900 liters per second of water into our geothermal fields. To both get rid of surface water, but also to maintain the production of the field. So it's something you have to keep in mind.
Thank you. Michael Keller from UBS. Who is actually an ideal or a natural investor into this CCS project? Is it driven by governments or by private investors? And if so, private investors, what are kind of the returns criteria for those investors? I guess something for Christian, I would say.
So I think if you look at the where CCS has been successfully done recently, I mean, if you look at Canada, for example, with the Boundary Dam plant, the Quest plant, and then the Alberta trunk line that's currently under construction, those have been a private and a public investment. I think it's very important for governments to participate, especially in the initial infrastructure development. The most expensive thing is building a pipeline. And if you don't build a pipeline, you need some kind of other method of transportation, either by ship using liquefied transport or actually by truck is possible. But I think what's become clear is a lot of the demonstration projects to date have been done by one operator. So every component of the chain, the carbon capture at the power plant or the industrial plant, the transportation and the storage, is all one organisation. And actually, it turns out, I think it's going to be very much better in the future if there are gas transportation and storage companies. And in fact, there's a project just going on in Norway at the moment, I think, with the Norwegian government and Statoil, I think using the Smeya field as the storage site. But actually a combination of, a waste-to-power plant, a cement plant, and I think a fertiliser plant, and with transportation by ship out to the field, so kind of like a floating injection system. So that's a combination of both public and private. I think it's very difficult just to do it on the private basis because, you know, the cost of carbon dioxide is so low, it's very difficult. Having said that, some industries are very impacted by not just necessarily the cost of carbon, but the demands, the corporate responsibility demands of their customers. I can think of two examples here. One's in the fertilizer world, where essentially when you produce fertilizer, you're producing a very pure stream of carbon dioxide. And many fertilizer companies are being asked by their customers, investors, what are you doing about that stream of carbon dioxide? The second one is in the plastics industry, bottlers who are basically producing plastic bottles for drinks from a petrochemical source are having real trouble competing against bioplastics in terms of the carbon emissions and their customers demanding that actually they have a low carbon emission plastic. And their CCS assumes a much greater value because of the corporate responsibility issue, and those companies are much more likely to spend their own dollars so on private enterprise and private funding. But essentially, I think to really make this work at scale, it's got to be some combination of at least public, private, and probably a public authority to drive the initial infrastructure development and the transportation.
Iskander Gökalp, the director of the French Combustion and Environment Institute. A question to Dr. Kumar. Is India envisaging also coal gasification and therefore pre-combustion capture? And also perhaps a second question, you are the only one who mentioned carbon utilization. What kind of utilization you may think of?
Could you please state the second question again? Yeah, so as to your first question is concerned, India is definitely working on coal gasification, especially in situ coal gasification. As far as utilization is concerned, as I said, there are some industrial sectors, notably cement and chloralkali, and there are some more, which are, some of them have already started working on pilot projects where they utilize CO2 capture from their plants. But no such pilot has been done or planned where these industries are going to use CO2 that is captured from a power plant. What is instead being researched is that whether the captured CO2 from power plants could be used for algal growth and use that algal, harvested algal for biofuel production, fourth generation biofuels. So those experiments are also ongoing.
David Elzinga from UNEC, a colleague with Christian. Any comments on the Indian speaker spoke about scaling it up. What about the converse of scaling it down in multiple units using a slipstream of emissions from plants? My reflection on this is simply we've had a number of cancellations over the last year. where countries, especially the UK, kind of pulled back on the billion-dollar or billion-pound level investments. Why not bring it down? And that could create potentially industrial opportunities, say, for a country like India. Also interested to know the scale up or down on the Icelandic solution as well.
Well, I don't think I should answer a question from my colleague, but I look forward to the experts, and David is much more an expert on the CCS technology than I am. But it's true, you perhaps have to take a different approach to developing the technology and perhaps put these large-scale, huge, humongous projects a little bit aside and focus on technological development at a larger scale and across multiple sectors. And we heard it, you know, the cement, the steel, there are a lot of applications that has to be developed in the future. But I'll just return also to John's point on where do we find the financing, because it has to be a public-private at this stage for two reasons: the political risk involved, as said, you know, because no companies, they will shy away from it. If you can't get a little bit of government backing and even UN involvement, you know, then it's going to be, you're going to be very vulnerable to criticism if something goes wrong. So we have to go in doing this together. And then the mechanisms for leveraging, taking the risk, the financial risk out of it also. When I was a minister, we developed new innovative financial tools, a climate fund, where we actually went in, the government and big pension funds and private companies together. And what we did in the government was we took a little bit of the risk for climate investments, and that allowed pension funds to come in big scale, and that allowed then companies to come in on top of it. And we could actually 10-double, 15-double the government financial flows and into mitigation by creating such innovative funds. And I think we need that at a hopefully global scale for the CCS technology. I think time has come to develop such innovative financial instruments that can really support industry in moving this technology forward. Because it is now, and low carbon prices and low prices on energy, it is going way too slow. And we need to really boost our involvement in bringing this technology forward. So, and it has to be a private-public global partnership in doing it, and it's about time to create it. Thank you.
Just to answer a couple of questions, I think somebody asked about earthquakes and the pace at which you can inject, and I think you asked the question about scale. I think on scale, it's pretty expensive to drill a well, you know, a water well or an oil well. And I think it's quite difficult then to sort of dot the country with lots of small wells and small storage schemes. I think in most countries there's a national geological association or department who will be able to, or who already have mapped out significant areas of storage. Now, some countries are more blessed than that than others. So I think on the scale piece, I think the most important thing is to build the infrastructure for scale, but then to enable it to build in small-scale additional increments of carbon dioxide at low cost. So that's why it requires the political and public investment to get the initial infrastructure. With the particular situation of France, I cannot recall that there's a relatively small set of aquifers in France, but you know, just offshore in the North Sea, bordering many European countries, is probably one of the world's biggest and most effective carbon sinks, with many depleted oil and gas fields, demonstrably capable of storing gas for many millions of years, and easily accessible. What it requires is the political willpower to build the appropriate pipelines offshore to take carbon dioxide from countries like France or Benelux or Germany and take it offshore through the Netherlands to the North Sea oil and gas fields. So that takes the problem offshore and out of sight and out of mind from people concerned about deep subsurface storage on the onshore, where people are more concerned about the consequences of pollution of aquifers or potential earthquake activity or minor earthquake seismic activity.
So the suggestion of scaling down is very valid. In fact, one of the startups in India has actually started on scaling down the whole thing for industrial utilization of captured CO2. But challenge of scale still remains if we were to mitigate high volume of CO2 from large power plants.
I find the idea of scaling down very interesting because I think it helps with public acceptance, but then it comes with the challenges that the gentlemen have talked about. In our case, we actually have two wells we're injecting, and we started off by injecting a small amount. And once we'd shown that we were making rock and we could, it's actually a thing you can show people from core drilling, I don't think there's any public resistance to scaling up as we have done and continue to do this summer. And just for reference, the geothermal power plant is in the backyard of Reykjavik, the capital city. It's only about a 20-minute drive from the city.
Just one more brief question, then we have to close the session because we have to do it on time.
I guess my question goes to a few of you who've mentioned the fact that CCS has a bad name. Who's going to be the marketing face of CCS or all the other terminology that might get invented so that there's a greater level of political acceptance and public acceptance to take this forward? You know, who's going to be the face of it? If it's business, there'll be a certain level of sort of cynicism with the green lobby. Is it government who've brave enough? Is it some multi-stakeholder process? So who's going to be the marketers?
Okay, let me have a go at this. So wouldn't it be great if the NGOs decided this was a great part of the mix? That would be quite convincing for quite a lot of people. I don't expect that to happen overnight, but you know, hey, why not work with people to bring them on board that this is part of a suite of things that need to be done to decarbonize the future? I think inevitably it has to be governments as representatives of people. They have to link it with, I think, policies around regenerating regions. So there are especially regions which are heavily reliant on coal or industries like iron and steel or chemicals. You know, these are often areas of deprivation or privation as those industries change. And I think CCS has to be built into the regeneration infrastructure and get the positive vibes, if you like, of that. So economic well-being and environmental positive impacts.
Thank you. And then I hope we can do something in the UN, because if we in the UN bringing together multi-stakeholders, government and civil society and private companies can create some kind of common understanding and consensus around the use of CCS, then I think that can be the face of CCS. And I hope our recommendations developed by experts, endorsed by member states, submitted to UNFCCC, I see many companies and actors within the field who really have hung on to those and said, look, the UN is there, and the UN is trying to do this in the right way and help us to do it together. And that is what the UN can offer. But it demands that you come to the UN and do it, because the UN is only hopefully we're a little bit more than the sum of our member states. But we are depending on good experts, good people coming together and developing these recommendations, taking it forward. And so then perhaps we can also play a small role in the UN. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Christian. There's still 2 or 3 minutes left, and I would like to use these 2 or 3 minutes for a brief summary of our discussion. I think we all agree, at least our session leaders and myself, that CCS is a central part of the solution regarding the mitigation of climate change, and the world is projected to move towards a low-carbon energy future where CCS-enabled fossil fuels, renewables, and energy efficiency all play a role. And it is not the question of either or, to use of one of these options, but we need to make use of all of these options in order to achieving the climate goals cost effectively. Policy will dictate whether CCS remains a niche technology or grows to widespread industrial practice. Governments are important for the establishment of an infrastructure. Industry is responsible for the investment, but we need financial incentives similar to the promotion of renewable energies. We need policy parity. And let me just briefly try to summarize what our discussion leader said, coming to AMIT. AMIT mentioned and pointed out CCS is very promising, but needs to be demonstrated at a large scale. Christian said we need to scale up all technologies, we need new financial instruments, and we need policy parity. Hildegunur, innovation is key, and it won't necessarily come from incumbents. We won't achieve COP21 goals without CCS. I would like to thank our discussion leaders, and I would like to thank you for attending this session and contributing with your statements to this discussion. Thank you very much.